bless him today. Hallelujah. 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 The Lord is great. He's greatly to be praised on this morning, this early afternoon now. He's great and he's greatly to be praised. He's great and greatly to be praised. Come on, somebody just say he's great and greatly to be praised. He's great and greatly to be praised. The Lord is a great God. He's a great God. Before we go into the word of God on today, amen, let's just go around the room. Let's just love on each other. Just come on, somebody, just go love on somebody. And just, you ain't seen them all week. You ain't seen them in a few days or whatever. And you just go and just thank them. And just say, thank, I'm so glad you're here. Come on, just say, I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. Come on, tell them, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. I'm so glad to see you. I'm so glad to see you. I'm glad to see you. I'm glad to see you. I'm glad to see you. Come on. Come on. Love on each other. That's right. Come on. Be thankful. Be thankful. And while you're in, and those who are all the way in the back, I need y'all to come all the way up to the front. Come on. Let's sit together. Let's sit together. Let's sit together. Let's sit close to each other. Let's sit close to each other. Let's love on each other. We are all one big family. Come on, let's fill in these roles. Let's fill in these roles. Come on, nobody sitting all the way in the back. Everybody, come on, sit on up here with me. Sit on up here with me. Come on, sit on up here with me. If you don't move, I'm going to call you up here, and I'm going to bring the camera to you. I'm going to bring the camera to you, and we're going to put you on Facebook Live this morning. I know that's enough to scam sometime, ain't it, right there? Amen. But we just want everybody to sit together and just love on each other. Come on, let's love on each other. Let's love on each other. God is in the room. God is in the room. God is in the room. Amen. God is, somebody say, God is in the room.
God is in the room.
God is yet in the room. Amen. Amen. I am so glad to be here. I'm so glad to be here in the land of the living. In the land of the living. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Is anybody just happy? If you're just happy, just put your hands together and clap. Just clap. Come on. Just clap. Come on. Just clap. Just clap. Just clap. Just clap. Now, you know, let's see, now this is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, right? And generally, right before Thanksgiving or right after Thanksgiving, and even more and more and more these days, there's an earlier and an earlier onset of whether it's the commercialism of Christmas and the holiday season, or just people just happy that the holiday seasons are coming. And yesterday I was walking down the street in downtown Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And as I was walking down the street, and I happened to look up at one of the buildings, and the building said Happy Holidays. And I was like, wow, it's not even Thanksgiving yet. But they were wanting to bring well wishes to anybody that walked past their building. And then most times when we see something, it takes our mind into something. When we see things, it takes our minds into things. The problem is with some of us, we've seen too many of the wrong things. And it takes our mind into the wrong place. But when you see spreading the word, or when you see your church, or when you see this thing or that thing or the other that's representing God, what is it that it takes your mind to? What is it that it takes your mind to? It takes your mind to great things, right? It takes your mind to worship, right? It takes your mind to blessing the Lord, right? It takes your mind for being happy. Is that right?
That's right.
All right, so one more time. Okay, I want you just to visualize God. Just the word God. What is it taking your mind into? Has anybody ever been rescued by God? Has anybody ever, do I have any saved people in here today? Are you saved? Are you saved? Are you saved? If you're saved, come on. And what does your mind take you to when you see the word God that flashed across your mind? If he's your savior, then how do you act when you need a savior? Do I have, now, there's a story in the Bible that talks about 10 lepers. It talks about 10 lepers. Somebody ask yourself, am I in the nine or am I the one? Come on, are you, somebody ask yourself, am I the one? Are you the one that thinks about God, and when you think about God, he saved you, and you, because you dared that you, now you was bold enough in your mess that you said, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me, right? You, was anybody who that saved, I'll say for me, when I got saved, I wasn't ashamed about being a sinner. I wasn't ashamed about being a sinner, so I know that I wanted to come out of that. So in order for me to come out of that, I had to say, Jesus, I want you to be my Savior.
Yes, yes.
And I ain't say it too quiet.
All right, Lord.
I ain't say it too quiet. I remember when I first went up there, when I first went up to the altar, and when I first started, they would tell us back in the Apostolic Pentecostal Church, when they would say, oh, you want to be saved? They would say, well, you need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And when they told us that we need to be filled with the Holy Ghost, they, back in that time, you know, because I'm an old man now and everything. And so back in that time, they said, you need to start saying, thank you, Jesus. Or hallelujah. They used to say, thank you, Jesus. Or hallelujah. They would say, come on, somebody just say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on. Somebody just say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, I know y'all already speaking more tongues than the UN. But it's all right to even say, thank you, Jesus. Come on, somebody just say, thank you, Jesus. Come on, somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Now, and the mothers did not allow us to be able to sit in our seat while we was at the altar. Now, in another denomination or whatever, they had a mourner's bench or something like that. But in the Apostolic Pentecostal Church, we didn't have a mourner's bench. We had to stand at the altar. And as we stood at the altar, we would have to stand there with our hands lifted up. And as we stood there with our hands lifted up, Facebook Live, y'all excuse me for a minute, because maybe y'all will stand wherever y'all at, but I don't even worry about the church that's here today. But I'm going to stand at the altar right now, and I'm just going to say, thank you, Jesus. I'm just going to thank you for the Holy Ghost. I'm going to thank you for saving me. I'm going to thank you for lifting me up. I'm going to thank you for blessing me. I'm going to thank you for changing my life. I'm going to thank you for changing my mind. I'm going to bless him today. Hallelujah to you, God. We thank you today, God. We honor you today, God. I honor you today, God. I bless your name today, God. Hallelujah. 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 I think of him as a savior. I think of him as a savior. I think of him as a savior. I'm thinking my sermon today, and I ain't preaching about 7 weeks, so I might be a little rusty, so y'all gotta bear with me on today. But my sermon text today is thinking about thanking. Thinking about thanking. Thinking about thanking. What are you thinking about? What are you thinking about? Somebody shout, what are you thinking about?
What are you thinking about?
The word of God. In Psalm 136. Well, before we go to 136, we'll go to Psalm 107. Psalm 107. Verses 1 and 2. This is an interactive sermon on today. This is an interactive sermon. Somebody just shout, I will participate. Yeah, an interactive sermon. You will participate. I'm going to join in into and for what God has for me. I'm going to join in. Somebody say, I'm joining in today. I'm going to join in with what God has for me. Psalm 107, verse 1 and 2. Psalm 107, verse 1 and 2. Y'all got it today?
Amen.
All right. And it says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy, who he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Can somebody just now, since I said this is an interactive sermon, I want you to just say, he snatched me out. Come on, can somebody just say, he snatched me out? The Lord has snatched me out. In this particular psalm, as we said, we're thinking about thanking on today. In this particular passage, this is book number 5 in the psalm. This is a thanksgiving to the Lord for his great and his mighty works. The Lord has been working on your behalf. Oftentimes in our life, we are feeling like no one is working for us. And we often feel like nothing is working out for us. We often feel like nobody has our interest at heart. We often feel like nothing is going to happen good for us. And we bring that spirit and we carry that spirit wherever we go. We carry it into places of happiness. And has anybody ever been in an atmosphere where it was real joyous until one person walked in the room?
Yes.
Somebody going, y'all going to help me in here today. Somebody tell your neighbor and say, neighbor, you will not be a Debbie Downer in here. We're not going to allow you to ruin my atmosphere. You're not going to ruin my atmosphere. This is what I said earlier. Now we know that Thanksgiving is coming, and you know, on this week, and you know, as Thanksgiving is coming and the holiday seasons are approaching, there will also be a time of reality where we will have to deal with Christmas parties and different things like that. And as we deal with the Christmas parties, then when we deal with the atmosphere, then we will see that there'll be an atmosphere of joyousness. There'll be an atmosphere of worship. There'll be an atmosphere, and you know, so you say it sounds crazy, there's going to be an atmosphere of worship at a Christmas party, right? Well, who do most people who are not saved worship? They worship the atmosphere. Somebody say, you're going to worship somebody. You're going to worship somebody. Everybody worships somebody. Well, I know that, you know, now the problem is, Adam, is that the people who are supposed to be worshiping God, they have turned down when they are supposed to be turned up. And the people who are supposed to be turning down, they have no shame in their game. See, somebody tell your neighbor, you've been too shameful. You're too shameful of your praise. You're too shameful of your worship. So God has given us a word today that says that we are thinking about thanking. We are thinking about thanking. Your mind has to be upon the right things at the right times, so that when you walk into the right atmosphere, you will get the right result. Many times in our life, we walk into the right atmosphere, but because our minds ain't right, we are not getting the right result. This is why people say, well, man, I went to that church and I ain't getting nothing. Well, what was on your mind when you went into that church? You cussed somebody out all the way to church, And then you say, well, I ain't going to be no hypocrite. So I'm going to come in and I'm going to mean mug everybody. I got this bill at home, so I'm going to allow my bill to override my worship. So somebody just right there, they made Commonwealth Edison they God. They made Commonwealth Edison they God. They made People's Gas they God. They made the person that they made, they boo or they bay, they God. They got mad at they bay or they boo. And so they mad at they bay or they boo. But somebody just need to tell your neighbor, God ain't your bay or your boo. God is God. He ain't your pay or your boo. God ain't got no time to be dealing with your attitude and your because you know God said, I ain't the one that did what he did to you. And said, I'm not the one that did what he did to you. Then why don't you give me what I'm supposed to have? I heard my old pastor, Pastor Geraldine Black, years ago, preach, give the man what he wants. Give the man what he wants. See now, and I'm going to take it a little bit further. You know, when I was on vacation earlier this week, we were sitting in the karaoke place, and one of the songs that the woman got up and she sang Clean Up Woman. She sang the song Clean Up Woman, and that song, for some of y'all who are a little younger may not know, that the song is talking about a woman who will come in and snatch your man because you ain't doing your man right. Now the devil is, he's wailing, and he is saying, you know what, I will be the best clean up woman that he could be, because the devil says, I want to come in and I want to snatch all of your joy, I want to snatch all of your blessings. I know that you thought it was good for a real, it was good for a minute, but let me help you here, that God ain't your bae or no your boo. So stop trying to give yourself over to the cleanup spirit. The cleanup spirit that says, I'm going to snatch you into degradation, and I'm going to make you turn down your praise, and I'm not going to allow you to have any joy in the position that you in. Somebody say, even in my worst, I still got a great praise. Understanding here, the word of God is speaking to us. Now I'm still a little rusty, so y'all pray for me. Pray real hard right now, okay? So it says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, the psalmist said, for he is what? Good. And what is going to happen with us? His mercy is going to endure forever. He's going to endure forever. So I know that you thought, because you were in your mess, you was in your situation, you was in your stuff, and that you have not forgiven yourself yet. But somebody just need to tap your neighbor and say, you need to get over it. You need to get over it. See, why do I need to get over it? Because God is with me. And even now, God was, he was there while he was looking at you in your mess. And I know y'all trying to put the blinders on God. You're trying to put the blindfold on God. But God said, look, I saw you in your mess. And I still saw that your future was more magnified than your mess that you are in right now. Your future is more magnified than the mess you're in. So God said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to release this simple word called mercy. And I'm going to release the word called mercy upon your life, because when this mercy is released upon your life, then it's going to have a perpetual effect upon where you're going in your destiny. And when you start seeing the mercies of God working upon you, then what happens is you will wake up in the morning and you will say, if it was not for the Lord's mercies, then I would be consumed. But somebody in here just need to tap yourself on the shoulder and say, I'm still here. I'm thinking about thanking. I'm thinking about thanking. I'm thinking about what God has in store for me. I'm thinking about how God is moving by his spirit and his power upon my life. And his mercy is greater than my mess. His mercy is greater than where I'm currently at. So he says after that, I'm going to let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. That is not a question that the psalmist has gotten from God. That is a command that you are, if you are redeemed, then God is saying you are supposed to say something about your redemption that has happened for you. Can somebody just shout to the top of your lungs and say, he brought me out?
He brought me out.
He is the propitiation of my sins. He is the purchaser. He is purchasing who and what I was, and he has recycled me into something better. I have been recycled into something better. I know that the devil had one plan for me, but I have been repurposed into something better. I am repurposed. Yes. The enemy thought he had something upon me in my life. He thought he could stigmatize me and keep me in that place of malfunction and dysfunction and distrust and mistrust. He thought he could keep me and hold me back. But God said all it took is one little drop of blood. All it took was a pinhead full of his blood, and it would overcome the magnitude of my mess. And when I began to think about the pinhead, come on, anybody here got a stick pin? Carol, I know you got it. You got everything in that purse. Come on, you got Home Depot in that purse. Come on, get out a stick pin out of that purse for me today. So a little stick pin that has a little pinhead. Come on, somebody say a pinhead. A pinhead will begin to work in the magnitude of your mess. The pinhead full of blood. Somebody say, check the DNA. You need to check the DNA. Check the DNA. Check the DNA and what's happening with the DNA. When the DNA says who is the father, we know who the mama is most times, right? But when it talks about who is the father, who is the father, who is the father, the DNA tells us who is the father. Now, I know y'all, you know, I know most of y'all are real ultra saved and sanctified and ain't never watched Maury and don't get off on Jerry Springer or Bill Cunningham when they're always doing paternity test. Oh, come on, somebody just ask your neighbor, who is your daddy? Who is your daddy? Who is your daddy? And when you start trying, see, many of us are having an identity crisis because we cannot figure out who is our father. We in the church, but we can't figure out who is our father. We are in the house of God. We say that we are of God, but our identity and our thankfulness is not lining up with who he is in our DNA. Oh, you look like him, but you ain't acting like him. Oh, sometimes I will tell my children, look, you may look like me or you may look like your mother, but you ain't acting like us. But God is saying, but that still is not the denial of the DNA. The DNA is supposed to get upon you and it will overwhelm you to the place when you may feel like you don't know who's you belong to. All they do, and I watch the scientists, they'll withdraw and extract. Somebody say, God is extracting something out of me. Oh God, he's extracting some things up out of your life. And as he's extracting the things of negativity up out of your life, then he begins to put a little bit of drop of fluid upon the petri dish or upon it. And as he puts it up, I'm trying to help y'all to think about thinking here now. He puts that little amount of fluid on there and he sends it off to the lab. Oh, somebody in here needs to know what you are in right now is called the lab. You are in the laboratory. You are in the laboratory and you are being tested. You are being tested in this moment. You are being tested in this particular time. Where you are at right now is a test and it's being tested so you can begin plan to get to a place called results. Oh, somebody in here, if you can just begin to give God a praise, I believe that some things may possibly be fast-tracked and your results can come a little bit quicker. Oh, I know, see, y'all saying, man, God, how long am I going to have to wait and to be able to know when I'm going to get the answer? Well, God is saying, because you are still sitting there like you were back in your yesterday, that means that you are happy where you are. Your mind, when you allow your mind to stay in the place where you are only going to deal with the sadness of your yesterday, that means that that is the place where you want to worship. You are loving to worship in the past failures. You're loving to worship in the past sadness. You're loving to worship in the past unforgiveness. This is why we walk around holding grudges, because we are allowing ourselves to worship in that moment of what the person you thought did to you, and you thought it was going to stick you there. But God is saying, if you can just start praising God for what you have had happen to you, then the next thing you know, that you are moving closer to that thing called results. Oh, come on, somebody say, I'm thinking about thanking. Oh, I'm thinking about thanking. I'm thinking about thanking him. Why am I going to thank him? Because he has allowed me to go into some things. He's allowed me to live through some things. And this is why the psalmist says in verse number 2 of 107, he says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. He didn't say, let the redeemed of the Lord sit there on your thumb. He didn't say, let the redeemed of the Lord be texting on your phone. He didn't say, let the redeemed of the Lord be Instagramming and selfieing and all the other kind of stuff. He said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Because the redeemed of the Lord is saying that, yes, I have been in the laboratory, and yes, I have been in the extraction, but now I have the thing of what I need. And so now, just that little pin, the top of the pin, can tell you whose you belong to. Just the top part of the pin. You don't need all of this amount of blood. You don't need this amount of blood. You know, now look at my cup here. My cup is full. You don't need this amount of blood. All you needed was a pin drop of God's blood. And when you got a pin drop of God's blood, that puts you into the place where you are in line for your result. You are in line for your result. Has anybody ever been in an airport? Have you ever been on a bus or a train? You stand in line. Or you've been to an amusement park and you said it's a 60-minute wait for the ride. They say 75-minute wait for the ride. And many of us even know it says 60, 75, 90, 120 minutes. What do we still do? We stand there and wait for the result of the ride. And ain't nobody complaining during the whole 2 hours that you waited. Only thing you is, you're getting more and more excited with every step you take. Somebody needs to get an understanding right there. You're looking at where you're not, but you ain't looking at your feet. I'm moving forward one step at a time. Oh, come on, somebody say, I'm moving towards my results. I'm moving towards my result. I'm moving towards my result. Yes, the result. The result I'm moving toward, and I'm happy about it. So what I'm trying to get us to understand is that God is saying, if we're going to be thinking about being thankful, is that you've got to be thankful for where you've been. You've got to be thankful for where you've been. So understand, when the girl broke your heart, guys, when the guy broke your heart, ladies, you got to be thankful for where you've been. You got to be thankful for the hurt and the heartache. Why am I going to be thankful for that? Because God has already promised that he's going to give you double for what you have been through. So while you have been in that hurting place, my mind is supposed to shift to the place of saying, yes, they hurt me, but I'm getting ready to get a double-fold blessing for the hurt that I've been through. through. Yes, the guy, he abused you and he hit you, but now God is going to send somebody into your life to spoil you and to caress you. Yes, the girl, she cheated on you, but now God is getting ready to send you a Proverbs 31 woman. Yes, the preacher may have hurt you over there, but now God is getting ready to send you a pastor and that will be able to help you and get you to the place of what you need to do. God is saying to each and every one of us that in this time that we are living in, that we have to be thankful for the moments in our life. We've got to be thankful for the time and the love that God will release upon us. Because when you are gone through hell and high water, then you've got to understand that heaven is on the other side. If you can just learn how to deal with the flames and the fires of life, then God will allow you to be cooler than the other side of the pillow. But you've got to learn how to praise him in the middle of the fire. A couple of weeks ago, Elder Perdue talked to us about that, right? He talked about Daniel being in the lion's den, right? We also know the story about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, right? That they were in the fire, but their praise produced a fourth one. What is your praise producing? Your praise has got to produce something besides more misery. Your praise has got to start producing things that will change, then transform the situation. So somebody say, thank you for where I've been. You've got to thank him for where you've been. And then you've got to thank him for where you are. You've got to learn how to be thankful for where you are. What is it that you want more of? Well, sometimes we can't get more of something because we ain't been thankful for what we got. You ain't thankful for what you got. You're only looking at what somebody else has. You're only looking at what somebody else is doing. You got to get off of this comparison and this contrasting. Don't worry about what the other people have. Don't worry about the car that they are driving. Don't worry about the church that they are having. Only thing that you should be doing, people, is trying to better the church that you serve in, and not worrying about what somebody else's church is doing. Only thing you should be doing, pastor, is improving your ministry, and not being comparison to someone else's ministry. I can't be John Hanna, but John Hanna cannot be me. I cannot be T.D. Jakes, but T.D. Jakes cannot be me. And the thing that we both have in common is that we both are trying to be the best one of our own individual lives. And when you learn how to do that, then God will begin to drench you with more power and more spirit upon your own individual life. And you will start maximizing where you are at. You don't have to worry about trying to write somebody else's book when God has already planted the book on the inside of you. You don't have to try to sing like Tasha Cobbs when God has already given you a voice to be able to release the worship that's about of you. And when you learn how to praise God where you're at, then something great will begin to happen. God will allow his power to come down upon you while you're in the middle of where you're at. Come on, somebody, just jump up on your feet and give them a where you're at praise. 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 I'm almost done here. I'm almost done. But I want to think about thanking him. I want to think about thanking the Lord. I want you all to begin to think about what God is doing in your life. What is God doing great in your life? What have you been through on this year that has gotten you to this day? This is why I believe it says, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. bread. How many of you all are worrying about what you're going to eat 5 days from now? You're worried about 4 days from now. You're worried about what's getting ready to happen on Thanksgiving. You're worried about how the dressing gonna taste. You're worried about how the peas and the carrots gonna taste. You're already fretting and fussing about who you gonna have to sit next to in your family that you don't like. Oh, did I just say that all? But I know some of y'all are already trying to come up with the excuse of how you're going to be able to not go to your loved one's house. But somebody say, God said, that you are a minister of reconciliation. I know it's hard to shout on that, but you got to understand that you got to get past all of your proclivities and all of the hatred that you have within the framework of the family. Because it don't make no sense for you to be shouting when somebody that next to you that don't have your DNA. It don't make sense for you to be saying, oh, that's my bestie, and that's this and that's that. And then the only time you want to holler family first is when somebody call your family out of your name. But God is saying, but you the same one that's calling them the same thing. Well, let me try to say it like this. Black people, y'all call each other the N-word every day of the week. And then when a white person or one of our Caucasian persons or Hispanic persons call you the N-word, how you gonna protest against Trump and he's saying the same thing that you saying? Oh Lord, it got real quiet, Adam. It got real quiet. It got real quiet. So somebody said, get over your self-hatred. Well, if you're going to protest, protest right. If you're going to protest, protest all of it. If you're going to protest, women, if you're going to answer to the name B or H-O-E in a song, then when somebody in your house call you a B or an H-O-E, then don't get mad.
Lord.
Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. I just stepped into something, Pastor. And I told you I'm rusty, so you got to help me here. Understand. When you are a person that's thinking about thanking, then you will also think about where you're at. You'll think about how God wants to use you to change your family around. He wants to use you to change the dynamic. He wants to use you to change the world. But you can't change the world if you're not thankful for where you're at. Again, you are on and in the laboratory going to the place called results. And when you start looking that you are in the laboratory and you start looking for the place called results, then something will begin to happen to you and it will begin to be real magnificent. The Bible tells us in 2 Chronicles chapter number 20 verses 18 through 21, and it says, and Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. See, understand something great will begin to happen when you begin to praise God where you're at. When you begin to give him glory where you're at. They were between a rock and a hard place, but they still said, and Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. One of the worst things that can happen is that when a church is in between a rock and a hard place, and the pastor begins to worship, and then nobody else worships with him. The worst thing that can happen is when the praise leader is in between a rock and a hard place. Praise leaders, have you ever just drug yourself into the house of God? You got there by hook or by crook, and you drug yourself upon the stage, and everybody gave you the blank stare while you was trying to get yourself into a place of worship. Adam, jump up on the organ real quick, please. And then you understand that there's a time in your life that has to be a community result of worship. There has to be a community result. See, when you get hooked up in the church, or you get hooked up in the faith family has got to learn how to worship together. The faith family has got to understand that the rock and the hard place is the place of the process of our destiny. The rock between the rock and the hard place. When a church can begin to worship, and when you are in between the rock and the hard place. Somebody shout, the rock and the hard place. That's supposed to produce your great worship. The between the rock and the hard place. That's how we are supposed to worship. When we are in that place where it feels like we are not going to be able to make it. You have been surrounded. Somebody shout, I'm surrounded. You're surrounded by pain, and you're surrounded by troubles. You're surrounded by all sorts of things that are happening in your life. And these things are trying to mess with your future. This is when you drag yourself to the house of the Lord. And when you drag yourself to the house of the Lord, you are supposed to come in, and somebody should be on your left or on your right, and they should be worshiping and praising your God, and they should be able to say, yes, I know that you are struggling right now, but you are in the midst of you struggling, I'm still going to praise God. And as I began to praise God, I'm going to believe that the struggle that you are having is getting ready to be drowned. I'm believing that the anointing that's on my life, it's getting ready to be transferable, and I'm getting ready to impart into you a power and the Spirit of God that's getting ready to change you forever. I believe that in the midst of what you're dealing with, even though you're sad and you're in between, that God is getting ready to do something great for you. I'm trying to talk to somebody here that's in the middle of the rock and the hard place. You are in between the blessing. You don't feel like you're gonna make it. You have heard all sorts of negative stuff, and it has tried to hold you down. But this is why when you come in the house, then you stand right there, and you began to hear the song of the Lord going forth out of the singer, or you hearing the word of the Lord going forth out of the preacher. That it should be something that connects within your spirit. And when it begins to connect, you be feeling your pain. The pain that you came in with, it begins to be drowned out because you are not looking at the pain that you're in. But you began to listen to the praise that's coming forth. So can somebody look on your left or right and say, hey, neighbor, the praise I'm getting ready to release upon out of my mouth is getting ready to drown the pain that you in, the things that you're struggling with, the pain that you are in right now. The praise that I'm releasing is getting ready to make the devil a liar manifested in your life. I know you hear it all the time, but sometimes it feels like when we hear him say that the devil is a liar, the more it seems like what he's been telling us is the truth. But what God is saying, just like when Jehoshaphat began to bow his head down to the ground, but then something great began to happen. They moved out of the pulpit and they walked into the pew. So can I have somebody that's on the second, third, fourth, or fifth row to just get up on your feet and even guess Jehoshaphat, the Pastor Gina, come here real quick. I want you to come on, come on, come on, I ain't got time. Come on real quick. You just stand right there and I'll turn around and bow your head and then lift your hands
Jesus.
And as she's bowing her head and lifting her hands, there is an anointing that's being released all through the sanctuary. And the next thing you know, all of Judah and all of Jerusalem, they began to go before the Lord. They fell before the Lord and they began to worship. And as they worshiped, come on, church, began to worship. I want you to think about where you've been. You're in between the rock and the hard place. But you see the pastor standing right there worshiping the Lord. She ain't just worshiping for her, but she's also worshiping about your future. Your future is connected to her worship. See, Jehoshaphat, he was not worshiping just for him, but he was worshiping for the future of Judah and Jerusalem. Come on, Judah, and come on, Jerusalem. What do you want to happen? Are you tired of being sick and tired? Are you tired of being between the rock and the hard place? Well, praise God, while you're in what you're in. Come on, somebody, while I'm in what I'm in, I'm getting ready to release a praise. I'm getting ready to release a worship. I'm getting ready to see the joy of the Lord be my strength. How can I know him as my strength? How can I know him as my reward? How can I know him as my redeemer unless I praise him from where I was? And it got me to where I've been. But now that I'm here, middle ain't enough. Average ain't enough. Mediocre ain't enough. I'm getting ready to praise him for where I'm going. Can anybody here see your future? Do you see where you're going? You got to praise him for the place of where you're going. Where are you going? I see better where I'm going because I praise him in my mess. I praise him in my struggle. Now I'm getting ready to praise him for my future. I'm getting ready to see blessings of the Lord raining down upon my life. I'm getting ready to see God's glory being made strong. I'm getting ready to see the anointing of God rest upon me. I'm getting ready to see God who's rich in mercy. I'm getting ready to see God who's mighty in battle. He fought for me because I praised him and he flipped it around. Come on, somebody. It's easy for anybody to praise God when you got the business, but praise him while you got the boss. Praise him while you got the business. Come on, somebody. It's easy to praise God when you on the top, but where you praise him on the middle, in the middle of where you're at. I know that you feel like people are pulling you down, but somebody just shake yourself and begin to say, leave my legs alone, because I'm ascending higher and higher. I will not be stopped. I will not be blocked, because the power of the Lord is upon my life. Come on and praise him, y'all. Give him glory. Come on, give him glory. Come on and give him praise. Come on and give him praise. Come on, think about it. Think about it. Come on, begin to think. Begin to think. Come
Come on, begin to think. Psalm 136. It says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, to the God of gods. Oh, I know that you had a bill, and I know you had a problem, and I know you had an issue, but when you turned your praise around, when you turned your praise around, your praise began to release the sound of heaven, and God of gods showed up. He began to show you who he really was. Do I have anybody that's in this place that has served and is serving the God of gods? Are you serving the Lord of lords? Do you serve him who's mighty? Do you serve him who is great? Lord, praise him one more time. Whoa. I'm thinking about thanking him. Come on and think about thanking him. Come on, somebody just began to thank him for every meal you give me. Come on, thank him for every meal you've been before, but you didn't start. Come on, thank him for every heart that you had. Come on, thank him for what's been ready to happen in your future. I promise you, if your faith will begin to feed your praise, come on, let your faith begin to feed your praise. Let your faith begin to feed your praise. Let your faith begin to feed your praise. Come on, let your faith begin to feed your praise. Let your faith begin to feed your praise. Come on, let it go. Come on, let your faith feed the praise. You're moving. Come on, somebody say the results are in. The results are in. Oh God. The results are in. The results are in for you, woman of God. Glory. Hallelujah. The results are in. The results are in. You dared to press through every crowd.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
You dared to push through every misunderstanding. You dared to continue to have a praise on your lips when everybody told you that you need to cuss your God and die. You lost everything but your praise. You lost everybody but your praise. God says he's getting ready to give you a whole new class of friends. For everything that it seemed like you have lost. He's getting ready to give you a whole new class of people. He's getting ready to release a whole new realm of anointing upon you. He's getting ready to release. Because you praised him. You praised him in your mere misunderstood moments. Sometimes in some areas, you didn't even understand yourself. But something, where the Holy Ghost continued to push you to get to the house of God on today. Where am I going? But you're still yet walking. Where am I going? But you're still yet pushing. Why am I going? Yeah, because you're still yet praising.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thinking about thinking. Thinking about thinking. You have a revolutionary praise that's on the inside of you. You have a revolutionary praise. That's a praise that's inside of you that's getting ready to shift things hugely. You are an atmosphere changer. You are an atmosphere changer. So just release your praise right now. Just release your praise right now. Release it right now. Release it right now. Come on, release it right now. Release it right now. Come on. Come on, release it right now. Come on, come on, release it. Come on, anybody. Oh, come on, hush your head. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Come on, come on. Hallelujah. There's more, woman of God, that's inside of you. There's more that's inside of you. Come on, there's more that's inside of you. There's more, there's more, there's more. There's a deepness that's inside of you. There's a deepness that God is about to release upon you. He's about to lavish you. He's about to lavish you. He's about to lavish you. Yes, 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 yes. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, put your hand there. Put your hand there. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, in the most shit. Somebody just began to praise him. Come on and praise him. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on and praise him. Come on and praise the Lord. We bless you, Jesus. We thank you for where we were. We thank you for where we've been. And Lord, we definitely bless you for where we're going. We bless you for where we're going. We bless you for where we're going. Ministry is not over. You hear me, Pastor? Ministry is not over. Ministry is not over. Through every pain that you've been through, this is the time of replenishment, reignition, refreshing. So there's people who have been through twice as much as you've been through. And they're going to need to hear the voice of somebody that can empathize with what they've had to deal with. You're getting ready to move into the engraftment of the other side. The other side is in your grasp.
The other side is in your grasp. Grab hold to it. Grab hold to it. Grab hold to it. Grab hold to it. Ministry is not dead in your life. Hey, ministry is not dead in your life. But life and life abundantly is your promise. Life and life abundantly is your promise. I stand in agreement that life and life abundantly is yours. Life and the overflow. Life and the overflow. Life and the overflow. Life and the overflow. The life, the life, the life and overflow of what God has in store for you to do. In the name of Jesus, I stand in agreement with you. I stand in agreement with you. I see it. I see it. I see it. I see it. It is in your grasp. So that means that it's got to be at least on this level. Because, no, I'm sorry. Let's go a little bit deeper. Because you got to be able to hold on to it. See, I ain't talking about just touching it. You got, it's got to be in a place where you can grab it. It is in your grasp. It's in your grasp. Come on, somebody, give God glory. Give him 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 glory. We bless you, Jesus. Come on and praise him. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, we thank him. We thank him. Jesus. He's here. Think about thanking him. Let that fuel your praise. Let that fuel your future. Let that fuel your future. You driving, but your tank ain't full. You driving, but your tank ain't full. Future. Fill it. Fill it with praise. Fill it with praise. Fill it with praise. Because what you are and who you are is who you are. Not being somebody else. Not being someone else. Not being your mama. Not being your daddy. Not being your grandparents. But who you are is who you are. And the ministry that he has for you to operate in is for you to operate in. For you to be able to provide the healing that you know that you can provide. Just stop being afraid. Stop being afraid. Because who you are is who you are. And the other side of who you are is greater than the struggle that you've been through. And guess what? You live through the struggle. So who cares? Who cares of who anybody want to judge you? Because you live through the struggle. And that's all that matters. Does that make any sense? That makes sense to you? That's all that matters. You live through the struggle. So since you live through it, it don't matter what they judge you about. Because they trying to hold you back there. And you all the way up here. Just take a deep breath in. Blow it out. Take another one in. Blow it out. Take another one in. Blow it out. You know what you just did? You just expanded your lungs. And you ain't did nothing but just put yourself in a position of elevation where others ain't gonna even be able to breathe where you at. So don't even worry about them because they're getting ready to fall up off of you. They're getting ready to fall up off of you because your future is so much greater than what you've been surrounded with. So just live in it. Live in it. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give God one more praise in this house. We love him today. Do you love him today? Do you love him today? Do you love him today? He's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. He's a mighty, 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 mighty God. He's a mighty God. We bless his name this afternoon. We're thankful and we're grateful for all that he has done and what he's about to do.